All around us, there are Santas and reindeer and Christmas trees, which is ridiculous in this heat, but it's like this every year. Occasionally, there's an image of a kangaroo in a Santa hat, but mostly we all seem to agree to pretend that it's snowing and cold. Because that's the way it's supposed to be. Russell and the kids are at the mall. It's full of Christmas music and plastic decorations. There's a Christmas Wonderland on level 3, where you can get photos with Santa. Poppy would love a photo, but the line is too long and her sister's eye-rolling too intense. I'm at home reading a book and I reflect once again that my husband can be really rather perfect at times. I love, have always loved, his delight in doing the weekly shop with his children. I hate supermarkets, more so when I've got a kid or two with me. But he, who loves a task, loves to get something done, enjoys the quiet pleasure of walking aisle by aisle, chatting with Poppy and Bear, debating cereals and treats. He comes back from these visits pleased with himself and the world. And during all the chemo and being so sick, he missed it, his rituals with the girls. At one stage, we were ordering our shopping online, which depressed him no end. And so, despite being exhausted and despite the pain in his chest and his back, he's down there today because there's something normal and wonderful about it. And he wanted that. And when he suggested it to the girls, they almost cheered. I'm Sophie Townsend, with Goodbye to All This, an original podcast from the BBC World Service. Chapter 4, Crashing Waves. When they get home, they're all in an uncharacteristically bad post-shopping mood. Russell tells me there's been an argument in the car when Bear asked Poppy why she had so many band-aids on her legs. Poppy tried to defend herself, recounting her cuts and bruises, but Bear knows that she's making it all up for attention. She tells Poppy she's a hypochondriac, and Poppy, who isn't quite sure what that means but knows it's not good, bursts into raging tears. The pre-Christmas crowds means there's a jam in the parking lot. It's taken them 45 minutes to get out of there, with the two girls screaming at each other. They're not even through the front door when he sends them both to their rooms, and they stalk off. I grab the bags from the car, and when I'm finished unpacking, I bring him some morphine, his afternoon dose. He winces in pain as he turns to take the pills from my hand. Should he see someone about his back, I ask. He ignores me, too riled up by the fight in the car to think about anything else. He hates the girls fighting, always has. As an only child, he's never understood the sibling stuff and wants his girls to be like his Auntie Joyce and Auntie Elma, who never fought. All the photographs smiling and happy. The ever-loving auntie delusion, I call it. They're 8 and 11, I say. I bet Joyce and Elma argued when they were 8 and 11. He doesn't believe it. It's worse now, of course, when he just wants the girls to be close, to love each other and help each other, whatever might come. I sit with him on the couch, wishing I could lean into him like I used to. I hold his hand instead. And I'm thinking of a photo we have of the girls up on the kitchen wall. It's a few years old now, taken on a beach holiday up the coast. It was summer, but it must have been chilly. They're both in hoodies. Their backs are to the camera as they stand in the shallows, the sea water around their ankles. Bear is about 7, I think, and her body is elongating. She's in skinny jeans, rolled up to just below her knee. Poppy would have been 4, almost 5, and looks short and squat in comparison to her sister. Her pink skirt is billowing in the wind. They stand, not too close, but together, looking at the crashing waves coming in. "They'll be all right," I tell him. "They love each other. They just don't know it yet." The girls come downstairs for dinner. Poppy's found a bandage to put round her leg. I ignore it. Russell ignores it. Bear starts to say something, but a sharp look from her father makes her stop. There's a night when the pain in his back gets really bad, and we don't know what else to do except go to the hospital emergency department. The girls happen to be over at their grandparents', and without having to organise them, hospital feels easy, almost comforting, like some couples go to the movies when the kids are away.
We just tried to make life easy for them and normal for them. I think it became clear that they didn't want to talk about Russell, and we respected that. We just did ordinary grandparent-grandchild sort of stuff. And it was lovely because it was something we could do.
Russell gets a bed in the emergency ward, but tonight it hurts to lie down. He walks around and around instead, up and down the floor, and a drunk with a bad gash on his head mistakes him for an orderly, tries to get him to deal with his bedpan. Russell almost takes the pan until a nurse intervenes. He keeps walking, occasionally interrupted by a junior doctor asking questions, checking his chart, or a nurse taking his temperature. Finally, they run a scan, and it turns out that the ache in his back is there because a tumour is pushing into his spine. The cancer has spread, which I think we both knew all along, but couldn't bring ourselves to say. The girls know their dad has been in hospital. Poppy asks questions. Did he have anything to eat in the hospital? Did he get jelly? What did the doctor say? If his back hurts, why didn't they give him crutches? Maybe crutches would help, or maybe a wheelchair. Bear stays silent. With the results of the scan, Russell and I visit the cancer centre. It's a week until Christmas, and there's red and green tinsel half-heartedly draped around the ward. We're here to see the oncologist, the head of the department, the one Russell likes and trusts will save him, to see what to do next, what this tumour on the spine means. We wait a long time. But finally, he calls Russell's name, leads us to his office, where there's a small plastic Christmas tree decorated with gold and silver bells. As he goes to sit in his chair, the head of the department knocks into it, and it sways back and forth, rather perilously, before it rights itself. He moves it into the corner, out of the way. In the cancer centre, Christmas is embarrassing. We sit down, and he tells us what I think we already know. This is the end of the road. The chemo hasn't worked. The radiotherapy hasn't worked. Russell's not a genetic match for a trial of a drug that we thought might work. Russell will die. And after this is said, the appointment feels like a very polite breakup. The cancer can't be stopped, and we won't be seeing the oncologist again. Russell will move on to palliative care, and his pain will be managed. "I have an appointment to see you after Christmas," Russell tells him. The oncologist smiles gently and says, "There won't be any more appointments between the two of them." "How long?" asks Russell. "Until he dies," he means. "2 months. Maybe a little longer. Maybe not quite that long." The oncologist looks at Russell. "I'm sorry," he says. "I'm sorry it's not better news." "Me too," says my husband. I stay silent. In the car, in the parking lot, Russell cries, and I cry. He holds on tight, and there's this awful desperation in the way he clings to me. The cancer centre is just next to the new maternity ward, and we watch as a couple bring out their new baby into the world, put her into the car, and then slowly back out of their parking space. "We drove at 10 miles an hour the day we took Bear home, remember?" he asks. And I do. In all our visits to the cancer centre, I've always thought how brutal this is. This proximity of the two buildings, too much life, too many beginnings and endings, too close for comfort. But today it's the only thing that makes us smile. We pick the girls up from their playdates and Russell suggests we go to the park. It's twilight and there's a gentle breeze. We take the dog and the girls run round with her, playing a complicated game of fetch she doesn't understand. Russell and I sit on a bench, watching them. And they run in bigger and bigger circles until they've reached the other side of the park. He and I sit, holding hands. But it's only when he sees them running back to us that he really breathes again. We don't tell the girls the news. We don't want to ruin Christmas. That's what we tell ourselves anyway, because Christmas is already ruined. Nothing is right. Their father is sick and they're sick of it. Poppy tells us that she has us all back, like her dad's. She wonders if she should take morphine. I tell her no and go hide his medications on a higher shelf. Bear spends a lot of time in her room. And then Christmas comes on a humid, grey day. The girls wake up and unwrap their presents. We shower them with gifts and they try to muster up some enthusiasm, but they can't really. They give their dad a new shirt and he tries it on. It's far too big. "Don't worry," says Poppy. "You'll get fat again when the cancer's gone." Bear rolls her eyes, tells her that Dad wasn't ever fat, will never be fat. It's rude to say he'll be fat. "Want your protein shake?" I ask him. He nods his head. After presents and breakfast, I make poached salmon and we drive over to my parents' place for lunch. I ask Bear to hold the platter of fish on her lap as we drive. Some of the juice dribbles out onto her jeans. She bursts into tears. I tell her it'll be okay. We'll wash the jeans at Grandma and Grandpa's. "Great," she says. "I smell like a fish and I'll be walking around in my undies all day." Her father points out that she won't be smelling like a fish and walking around in her undies. It's sort of an either-or situation. He's trying to make light of it. She looks out her window, silent. At my parents', she stalks into the room that was once mine. She finds an old pair of shorts to change into, and I take her jeans to wash. But she doesn't come out, sleeps the whole afternoon. Mum keeps asking if we should get her to come out to lunch, but I say no. When we're ready to leave, I go to her and she cries in my arms, but not for long. She tells me she's hot and tired. And she's sorry she didn't come out. She apologises to my mother too, who tells her not to worry about it.
At Christmas, Bear was quieter and quieter and quieter and not like a child at Christmas at all. And finally she just went into the spare room, which is where she slept when she was here with us. It just felt like it'd be wrong to go in and say, "Come out and have a great time," because it wasn't a great time because Russell was really sick. And she just stayed in there. I think she couldn't come out. She couldn't face it. So we just let her be.
The girls go up to their rooms to sleep almost as soon as we get home. Russell and I don't talk or watch TV or eat. We wait until it's late enough for bed and as we lie together in the dining room bedroom, I realise that this will be our last ever shared space because he'll never lie in our bed upstairs again. I ask him, when we should tell the girls. Let's not rush it, he says. I agree with him. This time, with this news, I'm in no hurry. When I know he's asleep, I get up and go walking. The night is quiet and cool, and I walk down to the park on the bay, where it's dangerous to go by yourself because the council still hasn't put lights in. I've got the dog with me, who would be no use if we came upon a stranger, but who makes me feel safe regardless. I sit by the water and I think about the girls, his girls. They're still so little. And the thing about this that he hates the most is that he won't see them grow up. The missing out, the missing them. He can hardly bear it. At the waterfront, I can admit to myself that I am so grateful that it's him and not me who won't get to see them. I get to stay. I get to watch. But there by the water too, I wonder how on earth I'll manage it. And I catalogue the mistakes I know that I'll make. And I worry about the things they'll miss, the things they'll resent they no longer have. That sense of calm he has, the way he just accepts things as they are, never gets caught up in the minutiae of their lives the way I do. And my mind moves on to the money because he's always managed the bills. And what if I don't pay the bills on time and the electricity gets cut off? And what happens when the light bulbs need changing and I'm not tall enough to reach them? And dinner. Every night I'll need to cook them dinner after I come home from work. And what if that's all too much? I wonder, really wonder, in all this existential worry, how often you can get takeaway and still be considered a decent parent. And what about that part of me that, despite all this, is glad that it's him and not me who misses out on it all? Will they see that part of me and will they hate me for it? I walk home, sneak back into bed, watching him sleep. I'm sorry, I whisper. God, I'm so sorry. We have to tell them. They go back to school in a couple of weeks, and they need some time to get used to this before the school year starts again. But it's hard to find the right time to do it. They spend a lot of time with their friends away from us. They go to movies, have sleepovers, the beach, anything. They come back to the house to say hi, but it's like they're avoiding us, which we don't entirely discourage. The two of us are silent and still, no fun at all. And Russell says he wants the girls to have a good summer. But I think that really, we're avoiding them. Because it's just so terribly sad to have them with us. Poppy has taken to wearing bandages round her foot or her arm, sometimes her head. The bandages move around her body from day to day, and she won't take them off for anything. She won't go swimming because the bandages will get wet. She takes a bath with the affected limb outside of the tub.
I'd see Poppy and she would have bandaged herself up. She was a wounded child. She was so deeply wounded, and this was just a really sad manifestation of it. It was really sad.
There's an afternoon I try to pull Bear to me for a hug and she winces. She's pulling away because she's at that age to start pulling away, but God, what a time to pull away. It's the smallest moment that wince, and she stops herself and lets me hold her for a moment, but I know she doesn't like it. She goes again to her room. She's got a sign on her door that says, "Advice for people wanting to enter. Don't." Her room, her heart, don't. We have roast chicken for dinner, which is everyone's favourite, but it's not a meal for the heat and no one eats much. And after dinner, we tell them that there's nothing more to be done and that their father will die. They fall into him and he holds them tight and they won't meet my eye. This is about him and them. They'll need me, but for now, they want him. Bear goes to her room. Advice for people wanting to enter. Don't. Poppy and I stand in front of the washing machine. I've convinced her that the bandages need to be cleaned. We unwind them from her body and she's worried how she'll sleep without them because her body really hurts. So she and I find an old sheet and tear off a strip to make what we call an olden day bandage, and she winds it round her wrist and it soothes her. I lie with her in bed until she's asleep and realise that with all these bandages, she's saying, "I am hurt and I don't know what to do and nothing makes it better." It's what Bear's saying too, I guess. We live with this coming death. It surrounds us all. Bear seems so much inside herself now, she's barely visible. She still laughs, visits her friends, goes for swims, eats lollies, sees movies. But she's gone from us. She doesn't meet our eyes. Except those times I see her on the couch, sitting with him, which she'll do for the longest time. Not touching, not talking. Poppy talks endlessly. She's frank and fearless, asking question after question about what it all means. She develops complex theories about cancer, about death, and about her father's place in all of it. After she's been playing up in her room one evening, she brings down a dress and hangs it up on the coat rack in the hallway. "Do you like it, Dad?" she asks. He does. He'd bought it for her in a second-hand shop, navy blue with white polka dots and piping. "I'm going to keep it down here now," she tells him. I'm wearing it to the funeral and I want to make sure it's handy so I can get into it straight away as soon as you die. Bear's sitting on the couch with her dad, and I think she's about to say something to her sister, but she just takes his hand, strokes it. But Poppy senses something's not right and says, "I thought it was a good idea." She says it so quietly, he almost misses it. But he pulls her close on the other side of him. And he looks at me, holding both his girls, and shakes his head in wonder. And when I tell them it's time for bed, they rise together, and I watch them standing. And it's almost as if they're standing in the shallows, looking at the crashing waves. Goodbye to All This is produced by me, Sophie Townsend, and Eleanor McDowell. The music has been specially created for the podcast by Jeremy Wormsley. Alan Hall is the executive producer. The consultant story editor from CBC Podcasts is Chris Oak. The BBC World Service podcast editor is John Minnell. It's a Falling Tree production for the BBC World Service.